It is good to be together this day. God has given us today. He's called us to worship Him. And that's what we do. And we welcome you. If you're visiting today, we welcome you. If you are with us online today, we welcome you. It's good to be together and to give our worship to the Lord. The call to worship today is from Psalm 107. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. And I'd ask that we stand before we sing one of the beautiful songs of Father's Day. Let's stand and we'll receive the greeting that comes from our Heavenly Father. Grace, peace to you. And these are from God, our Heavenly Father. They come to us in Jesus Christ, our Savior, our Lord, who we love, and through the work of God and His Holy Spirit. Amen. This is my Father's world. The world belongs to God. And we sing that hymn now this Father's Day. It's 21 verses 1 through 3. And the words, I think, will be on the screen as well. 21, 1 to 3. Let's greet each other in that spirit of gladness and joy. Great day, but I'm looking forward to next Sunday too. Let's continue praising the Lord. Our next hymn is Praise the Lord. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven. 571. We can remain seated, but let's sing the three stanzas together. Praise my soul.
Thank you.
Sure is wonderful to have a Heavenly Father, and He helps guide us into the way of love. That way is open for us in His Word. I'd like to share a few words from Exodus 20. God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to a thousand generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that's in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. When these commands are studied, they fall into two areas: love for God and love for others. And that's what God wants from us. He wants to see us living in a loving way to Him and also to one another. Now, as we go to Him in prayer and we try to seek help from Him in doing these things, there are a couple of announcements and might say ways to show love to others. One is to, perhaps you are aware of this, Boyd Meyer passed away earlier this week. Boyd is Larray Meyer's brother, and the service information is that the visitation for him is going to be this Tuesday from 9:30 to 11, and the funeral will be held at Wellsburg Reformed Church. The visitation also at Wellsburg Reformed Church. The funeral at 11 on Tuesday morning. So we have an opportunity there to comfort and pray for their family in this time of loss. We also anticipate July being a busy month. Sometimes we have coffee fellowship on the first Sunday, but we are going to be having, for a couple of reasons. Coffee fellowship we will not have during the month of July, but we plan to resume that in the month of August. So we want to make that note in the scheduling. We can also pray for our brothers and sisters at Wellsburg Reformed this weekend. The search committee there has been working with a pastor by the name of Zach DeWitt. Zach is visiting their church this weekend and preaching for them, and we can pray for that and ask that God's will be done there. May He bless that as well. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, it's such a wonderful word that we need not address you only as God, which you are, but address you as our Father, because you have in Christ related to us as your children. Lord, we praise you today for life and hope. Thank you for your provisions today and throughout life. We give you thanks for rain that is coming right now. And we pray that this will continue, that the crops will get what they need. Lord, we pray for those who have special needs for healing. We are thankful that Ray Haupt's surgery on his colon went well this past week. Thank you that he's home from the hospital, but please continue to bring healing to him. In that light, we lift up Robert Naderhoff too, following his motorcycle accident. We pray that you will bring healing to him in the road ahead. We lift up the Meyer family this morning, following the passing of their loved one, Boyd, this past week. Lord, would you give them the peace and comfort that they need in this time of loss, and particularly his wife, Dolores. Be with her as wife of so many years. Lord, we lift up those battling cancer, too. We mentioned some weeks back Patty Eaton, Lord, as she undergoes treatments for breast cancer. May they be effective, and may she feel better. We lift up Perry Steinmeier, too, as he has a brain tumor, and pray for your blessing in his life. Thank you that our community could have Wellsburg Days this year and celebrate it. Thank you that the coronavirus situation has improved in our community to the point that we can do these sorts of things again. And we are thankful for progress and be able to fighting diseases like coronavirus. Lord, we pray for other countries that are struggling right now, for places in India, places in Africa like Uganda, as they were put in lockdown again this week by their president, and as Henry, one of our friends who ministers in Uganda, noted the loss of a key mission leader this past week named John, and we pray for them as they mourn his loss too. Lord, we pray for the ministries that extend medical care around the world, for the Luke Society. Lord, as our offering is held for that cause today, bless those who give medical care around the world, doctors who give of their time and talents, especially in underserved areas, that people who have need for the care that they provide can receive what is needed. And we ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Sisters and brothers, I mentioned that our offering cause this morning is for Luke Society, and the plates are in the front and back, and you're welcome to give as the Lord leads and blesses to that cause. One of my favorite songs is our next hymn. It's Great is Thy Faithfulness. And think of the faithfulness of God as we stand and sing number 348, verses 1 to 3. Let's join together and ask for God's blessing in prayer. Lord, as we come to the time where your word is administered, and we pray that this word may be faithfully proclaimed, but that it may also settle into the heart and soul, where it can form and shape us, that it may make a difference, that we may be blessed as your children, that we may have a sense that we belong to you, our Heavenly Father. And in Christ Jesus, we pray, amen. Sisters and brothers, in the grace of the Lord, I invite the children to come forward. We have a children's moment this morning. All right. Good to see you guys. Hey, I have something I'm going to show you guys, and girl too. You can come on up and have a seat. You guys and girl, you've seen this before, right? You know what this is. It's the chain, big heavy chain. I brought this to church today, and I thought to myself, I wonder what it would be like if I had to wear this chain today. Put it around my neck. Ooh, that's kind of heavy. You have a chain at your house too?
No, I have necklaces.
Oh, necklaces. Yes, yes. That's good. I know this is kind of a big, heavy necklace. If I had to wear this all day, I wonder, that would be kind of a hard thing, wouldn't it? I was thinking, after church, I sometimes take my tie off. I wonder how hard it would be to get this off if I had this chain on. Or what if I had to wear the chain all the time? You think you could get your clothes on even in the morning if you had this thing around your neck? It'd be hard. Well, maybe I don't want this thing around me. Jake, do you think you could take this off from me? Okay, see if you can get it off. One thing is, okay, I'll take that. Were we going to get a new microphone at all for the pastor? thanks. You took the chain off, and that is a big gift. And you know, that reminds me of something else that happened. Because when we sin, it's kind of like a chain that goes on us. And I think of different sins as maybe different links on the chain. And when it goes around us, it's kind of a miserable thing. But Jake came and he took this off, and it kind of reminded me of something that my Savior did for me. Jesus saw that I had sins in my life. And he said, Steve, I am going to die for those sins for you so that I can take this off of your neck and you can live in freedom with me. I think that's pretty great. That's what Jesus does. He takes the chain of sin off of us. And to celebrate that, let's have a little bit of prayer, and then I'll give you guys some candy, okay? Thank you, Lord, that the chains of sin have been removed by Jesus. And we pray that we'll celebrate that today and all the time. In Jesus, amen. Okay, choose something good. The scripture reading today is Galatians 4 and Galatians 4, 1 through 7. And in a minute, I'll have it up on the screen. Let's see here. The word of the Lord comes to us from Galatians 4, 1 through 7. What I'm saying is that as long as heirs are underage, they're no different from slaves, although they own the whole estate. They're subject to guardians and trustees until the time set by their fathers. So also, when we were underage, we were in slavery under the elemental spiritual forces of the world. But when the time set time had fully come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. Because you are his sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts. The Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. So you're no longer slaves, but God's children. And since you are his children, he has made you also heirs. What an amazing passage, and what amazing things to say for us to think about today. I'd like to start by observing that I am so glad to live in this day and age. It's a day and age when we have GPS. And I need GPS. I need directions to where I'm going. And one of the things that I like about GPS, and we just used this feature yesterday, is let's say that you get off the track from where you're supposed to be. Well, the GPS can recognize that and help get you back on the track of where you need to be, so that you're not going the wrong way anymore, but that you can be restored to going in the right direction. The Apostle Paul is like a GPS for the Galatian church. They started out well enough. He had come into town and preached the gospel, and there was faith in Jesus Christ, and they started strong. But then there was something else that came into their spiritual lives and their spiritual walk. And they who encountered God's laws in the Old Testament started thinking that they needed to obey those laws in order to earn their salvation. And Paul knows this, and like the good GPS he says, no, not that way. Go this way. He, in his letter, talks about them observing special days and months and seasons and years. You go back into the Old Testament, and there's very detailed instructions on how to follow certain days and special months and seasons and so on. And I don't think that it's necessarily wrong in itself to celebrate certain days and seasons and so on. We do that a lot, really, as the New Testament church. But where we get into trouble is when we start thinking that by obeying those things, we are earning our salvation. God's law can't really accomplish that for us. We're born in sin. We're in a position that we can't do that. It won't work. God's law does have some other good things that it can accomplish for us. In Paul's way of thinking, by God's giving the law, one of the benefits is that we have a way of kind of labeling sins. We have an ability to have an understanding of our sins when God reveals his will to us. And even in another way, God helps us know how we can respond to what he has done for us by trying to praise him and obey him and do his will. But those laws weren't meant to be our means of salvation. that won't work. Instead, God had a different plan. He resolved that he would send us his son, that his son would be able to do what we could not. His son could pay for our sins and rescue us from our sins, take the chains off, so to speak, and redeem us so that we are saved and brought into the family of God. And we'll reflect on that beautiful truth today. And I challenge you this afternoon, even if you have time to think about that a little bit, think about the truth that you and I who believe in Jesus Christ aren't just members of a physical family. You know, my last name is Mulder, so I'm in the Mulder family, and your last name is, you know, whatever your last name is, so you're in that family. But think of us as adopted children into the family of God, such that we approach God as our Heavenly Father. Paul has a lot of interesting ways to teach this, and they're in our passage. One of them is to talk about the situation in which somebody is an heir to an estate, but they're also very young. And when they're so young, he says, they're really not different, at least in some ways, from a slave, even though they own the entire estate, because they're subject. You know, slaves are subject to the owner of the estate. Well, the heir is subject to guardians and trustees until a certain time that the father has set. And in our salvation, in God's plan of salvation, God set aside a time to send his son Jesus into the world. And in view of that, the situation is way better. Jesus had to come at the set time for us in our salvation. And he did, so that we could live in the blessing of having the chains lifted off, have the blessing of not being in slavery to sin. Instead, we are the children of the Heavenly Father. This past week was a special holiday in Juneteenth. And I was wondering about what it would be like to be sent to tell those people who were slaving away that slavery was done. What would it be like to be that first person who brought the news? That'd be an incredible thing. Slavery is done? What? I'm free? Oh, praise the Lord, I'm sure was heard many times in the South when that happened. But then I thought to myself, wait a minute, because preachers and missionaries announce the news that we're freed from our sins because of what Jesus has done. And it is an exhilarating thing to be able to share good news today in a world where there's so much bad news, that we can share the good news that in Christ there's reconciliation with God, like we would say last week, or in Christ there's freedom from our sins, as we say this Sunday. Christ has delivered. That's one of the images that Paul uses in our passage. And I think the reason why he uses this image is, one of them anyway, is because the Galatians had been concentrating on their own efforts. But he wanted to help them see God's effort of grace. A slave really can't earn their freedom in this sense, in the spiritual sense. Instead, Jesus says, this is my gift to you. Well, to get us a little bit into that more, let's look at another image that Paul has in our text. The image of adoption. And I know there are people who have been adopted into families, into earthly families, and a blessing that is in their lives. I have a cousin who was adopted. Her name is Anna. I remember as a pastor, a person in my congregation, my last church, had asked me, Patty and I are going to the court to have it officially, you know, recognized that Sophie's going to be in our family, and could you come with us? And we're going to have a special celebration after that at a restaurant, and we'd like you to be there for that. And it's just such a happy thing when there's a bringing into, when a person finds belonging into a community that cares and loves them. And I think that too is a reason why Paul gives this image, that of adoption. It's not something that is earned, it's a gift by the parents. It's the Father in heaven saying, I am going to bring you into my family. I'm going to do what has to be done. I'm going to send Jesus to die on the cross to pay for your sins so that you can come on in and belong in my family. It's such an amazing thing that God would do that for us. Hey, come on in. Join my family because of what Christ did. And he not only does that, he wants us to know it. Now, I know sometimes there's a decision to be made in families. Do we tell, you know, if they're adopted very early, do we tell them that they're adopted, or do we just have them live in our household as our son or our daughter and never say anything that they were adopted? God wants us to know. So he sends the Holy Spirit into our hearts. And that alone tells us that Jesus has done something special. For a holy God to be in this sinful life, something must have been done about these sins. The chain must have been taken off for the Spirit to come into the heart in a good way and to say, Abba, the Hebrew word for dad. I think in that God is trying to teach me something that I need to learn and celebrate. He is teaching me that I belong to him as his son. I've been adopted in, and that I can look to him, the God of heaven and earth, as my heavenly father. But I think that God wants us to learn that and to put that into practice, and one of the ways that we can learn that and put it into practice is by praying. The Lord Jesus, he wanted to teach this to us. He wanted to teach what he was doing, what effect he was going to have on us. When in Matthew 6, he looked upon his followers and he says, when you pray, say, Our Father. Now, I know we can address God as he's revealed in his word, he's Almighty God, and we can pray, or Dear Lord, and we can pray, but Jesus here says, know this, you can address God as our Father in heaven. And I remembered reading in the Heidelberg Catechism a little bit of what does it mean when we can look to God and say, our Father. And it says, at the very beginning of our prayer, Christ wants to kindle in us what's basic to our prayer, the childlike awe and trust that God through Christ has become our Father. Our fathers don't refuse us the things of this life. God, our Father, will even less refuse to give us what we ask in faith. That's what the Catechism teaches about our Heavenly Father. You know, he is a good, caring Heavenly Father, and we'll reflect on that in just a minute. But the Apostle Paul went a little bit further, didn't he? He didn't just want us to know that God wants us to know who we are, but also whose we are. I'm in the family. He calls us heirs. Now that gets into something, again, that's, you know, we're all familiar with this, that, you know, earthly fathers, quite often, when they pass away, they will give their estate, I guess is the legal name for their things and their possessions, they will give their estate to their children. And Paul is aware of this, and he wants us to realize that we are heirs of the Heavenly Father, not that the Heavenly Father is going to pass away and then we're going to receive whatever he had. The Heavenly Father is eternal God. He's alive always, but he's a father in the sense that he seeks to bless us with things and give us his goodness, even in an everlasting sense. Say, this Heavenly Father is eternal, and his blessings to you are going to keep on coming, and not just in this life, but in the life to come. And I want you to know, it's a blessing to be able to think about this with you today. Father's Day. It's a day when we remember our human fathers. But this week I thought, let's challenge each other not to forget our Heavenly Father today, the one who sent Jesus so that we could be freed from our slavery and be brought into a family where we belong. It touches on a deep need, doesn't it? The need to belong in a caring family. Bring us into his family, and even as heirs, a father who continually blesses us forever. Now, I want to share something with you. This issue first came to my attention when I was in seminary already. I remember having a discussion about this, and just this morning I received a letter from Steve Cleary. He is the founder of Revelation Media in Texas. And he was reflecting on Father's Day and how he did not have a good earthly father. I don't know what the circumstances are. He didn't open that up in his letter. But he said, for some, Father's Day brings painful memories. And I know for those who maybe didn't even have a father, maybe their father died at an early age. Or maybe their father was kind of a distant father, didn't really have much to do with them in their lives. And he said, it's hard for people who are in that situation then to relate when the pastor talks about having a great father or that God is like a father. And then they think, oh, I don't like that because my father wasn't that good to me. And now you're telling me God is like a father? I remember in school just realizing that truth. You know, not everybody has a caring earthly father. But then I had a teacher who said to me, but you know what? In that situation, you have a wonderful opportunity in ministry. Because you can hold out the Heavenly Father as the caring father that they maybe never had an opportunity to enjoy in this earth. And Steve Cleary, in his letter, he mentioned three or four people who God had given to him in the course of the years who kind of functioned as a father to him. But then at the end of his letter, he said, praise God, our Heavenly Father. And he really essentially said the same thing as my teacher so many years ago. He said, for those who maybe didn't have an earthly father, challenge them that today is Abba Day. It's Heavenly Father Day to praise the one who in Christ has brought us into his family and who cares so deeply and loves each of us, his children. If you've had a Christian dad, rejoice, give thanks for that today. God also, our Heavenly Father, wants us to honor our fathers and mothers. We read that in the command, don't we? That's one way we can love our neighbors. And honor your father and mother, it says, so that your days may be long in the land. There's a blessing connected with that. I think a little bit again of the catechism. How did the catechism understand that command? It says, I need to honor, love, and be loyal to earthly fathers and mothers and all those in authority over us. So there's a wider aspect to that. But to obey and submit to them as is proper when they correct and punish. Sometimes we're going the wrong way. Sometimes our earthly fathers and mothers correct us and say, no, not that way, this way. But then it adds, be patient with their failings. I think that has something to say to every one of us, because no human father is perfect. Be patient with them. And then it adds, through them, God chooses to rule us. Think, oh my, that's a big thing to think about, that God can be operating through people in our human families to help us along, even our earthly fathers. And I would say, not just in the good things. God can also work through their failings. And maybe we see some of their failings and think to ourselves, I don't want to do that when it's my turn. I want to do it differently. And that can be God saying, learn from this situation and do it better. So God is our Heavenly Father, but He calls us also to honor our earthly dads, fallible though they be. He's doing things in us through them. Said we'd reflect a little bit on being adopted. I wasn't an adopted son. I know my biological parents, and I grew up in their family. It wasn't really something I had in my life. I know others who were, and they were brought into families, and it was a blessing for them. But today, I am challenged to think to myself, Steve, but you really were adopted, because God in Christ brought you into His family, and you're an heir of the blessings because of what Jesus did for you. It's quite a thing to think about. Adopted into the family of God. And you too. And then I thought, you know, if that's so, if my brothers and sisters in Jesus are adopted into the family of God, then I can see you as fellow members of the family, kind of like fellow brothers and sisters. And sometimes Christians talk that way, don't they? You know, brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so. And that's just a way to acknowledge that in Christ, God has brought us into one family. And I think to myself, for those who have, and I think this is all of us, a deep need to belong, how exciting. God has given us and administered and touched on a deep need that we all have, a need to be found in a loving family, the family of God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, let us pray. Father in heaven, what a joy. You've brought us into your family, and help us not to take that for granted, but to celebrate that. Dennis and Patty and Sophie celebrated with a dinner, a special celebration, and today we celebrate together that you in Christ have brought us in, so that we belong, and that you are a loving and close Heavenly Father for us in Christ. You've taken the chains away. The slavery is gone to sin, and we can live in the freedom and the joy of Jesus Christ. And thank you that we are not only children, but heirs. And just as earthly parents often give their estate to their children, that you give us blessings everlastingly. But thank you also for earthly fathers, Lord. We know that you're at work through them, and that even though they're not perfect, you continue to teach us things. But what a blessing today to know that we are adopted in to the family, to your family. In Christ we pray, amen. Let's sing celebrating what God has done for us, and the hymn is Amazing Grace. It's not something we did in our own works. We didn't earn this. It's a gift from our Heavenly Father to bring us in. Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. It's 693. Let's stand and sing the five stanzas, and the words are going to be on the screen in just a minute.
Thank you.
Think of that, an everlasting Father with everlasting blessings. We've no less days to sing His praise than when we first begun. Hallelujah. May our Heavenly Father grant you all His blessing this week as you go out and serve Him. Walk closely with your Heavenly Father. Listen to that Spirit calling out, Abba, Daddy in heaven. May God bless you and keep you. May He cause His face to shine on you and be gracious to you. And may He turn His face to you and grant you His peace. Amen. There is a Redeemer, that one who took the chains off. It's 833 verses 1-3, our closing hymn. There is a Redeemer, God's own Son.